All right, good evening, everybody. We're about to get started. Welcome to another great night of the College of Complexes. We meet here every Saturday from 6 p.m. until 9 p.m. here at 2901 West Addison in Chicago, Illinois. We have a couple simple rules and a simple format. Two rules. One rule is only one fool at a time. Second rule is no personal attacks. Can we handle that one? No personal attacks.
Oh, yes.
Thank you. And the agenda is simple. We have announcements. After announcements, we have the speaker. After the speaker, we have Q&A. After Q&A, we then have remarks, rebuttal time. All right, and also we have a website. Tim, I think you're going to talk about the website for this, right?
Proceedings will be videotaped and be made available on the web. As of right now, we have got over 6 years of archived videos on the web. You can access past videos of the College of Complexes by going to our website at www.collegeofcomplexes.org. Click on the camera icon and you'll see a link to our last presentations. You can also get them through my own website at www.timsvideo.com. And when you see the website, it's self-explanatory. Both places to access them are an easy guide. And next announcement, please.
Charlie. Come on, Charlie, let's go.
We're ready to introduce our speaker tonight. I didn't get her bio, but let's just get right to it. And please, go ahead.
Thank you so much. My name is Joan Levin. I'm the legislative director of an organization called Illinois Right to Know, GMO. Okay, GMO. Did any of you come to the talk that Mike Derschmidt and I, he's not able to be here tonight, I'm very sorry to say, the talk we gave last year, it was last winter, it was a very cold night, about genetically engineered foods. Back at the old, you were there at the old place on Alston, right. Okay, well, you know, this is a college, okay, so colleges have classes that are like 100, 200, 300, right? Okay, the lecture that I gave back then was GMO 101. It was the very basic stuff. I'll go back over a little of it, but not a whole lot of it, because this is going to be a different part of it. GMO stands for genetically modified organisms. We don't use that term really. It isn't technically correct. We really should say genetically engineered food, and that's what I'm going to be saying from now on. The GMO got to be such a commonly used expression that it's still with us. GMO 102 was basically how industry tries to make you think that these are useful and good for you. That's kind of myths of industry. And what I'm going to be talking about tonight mostly is GMO 103. This is the advanced course on labeling, getting labeled. Because whether or not you think genetically engineered foods are good or bad or have no opinion, many people feel that they'd like to be able to take a box off the shelf or a can of something and look at it and have it say, made with genetic engineering, just those four words. And then you can decide, yes, I'd like to buy it, I'd like to eat it, I'd like to feed it to my family, or I would prefer to buy something else. So this is what we're talking about right now. And that's going to be mostly the subject of what's going on, because I'm sorry to say that even this very simple addition of four words on a label, made with genetically engineering, has meant great, great opposition from industry. So I don't want to overstay my welcome here. 532. All right. Moving on to the next picture. I dedicate it to Dr. Francis Kelsey. Does anybody remember that name?
No.
Okay,
who remembers thalidomide?
Oh,
okay, yes. Most of you remember that. She was the scientist at the Food and Drug Association, who was a very young woman when she was asked to approve this drug, whether it should go out to pregnant women in the United States. It was already being used in Europe. She said, wait a minute, I've seen some animal studies that bother me. I've seen some neural issues, nervous system issues in animals, and some other problems. I want to have that straightened out and be sure in my own mind before we start giving this pill to lots and lots of people all over the country that it's really safe. and she dragged her feet on it. And the manufacturer put her under a lot of pressure. They put the Food and Drug Administration under pressure. The Food and Drug Administration put her under pressure. You know, get on with it. Approve it already. She said, no, I still have some questions. And then during that time, the reports began coming from Europe, where it was being used, of babies born terribly deformed. And so since this was in the early 60s, and since my children were born then, I feel a great debt of gratitude to Dr. Kelsey, and I dedicate this whole talk to her and to other scientists at the FDA and elsewhere who've spoken out bravely about genetically engineered foods and have done their best, often at great personal cost, to protect the public. So in that context, we move on. Consumers want to know. Overwhelmingly, they want to know, and we've had many questionnaires, studies, polls that have shown that consumers want to know what's in their food. They want to know if the foods they buy for themselves and their family is genetically engineered. And we're not talking about a great big explanation. We're just saying four words, made with genetic engineering. Okay, most of you already know that crops are mostly engineered in the first place to allow for two things. Number one, to allow toxic pesticides, toxic weed killers to be spread on the crops. So the crops don't die, the weeds are supposed to die, right? But these weed killers are very toxic. World Health Organization just called one of them, the most commonly used in Roundup, a probable carcinogen. It's in our air, it's in our water, mainly because of the amount that's being used on genetically engineered food. So that's an environmental thing that many people are concerned about. Another way that plants are engineered is to produce internally a toxin which bursts the cells of insects. So it's like an internal insecticide. The problem is, now we know, we've got a lot of evidence that this also does bad things to the beneficial bacteria that live in our gut that are very good and that are very important for our bodies. And so people have become increasingly concerned about the results of this as well. So issues in the genetic engineering process itself may produce challenges to health and safety. We're knowing more and more about the genome, the string of genes that make up our chromosomes, and how you can't just take one out and stick another one in like Lego blocks. They communicate with each other. So you think you're changing one trait, but you might be changing other things as well that aren't so desirable. And finally, genetic engineering as it is today, even though they like to talk about all the wonderful new foods they can produce, the plants that are on the market today in your grocery stores are almost all, I mean 98%, are plants that are producing benefits to the producers, not to you, the consumers. So, a lot of corporate myths, very quickly, because this is GMO 102. Genetic engineering is not the same as traditional plant breeding. We don't have a problem with that. We don't have a problem with, you know, hybridization does have some problems, but it's not these problems. We don't have a problem with saving seeds, to save the seeds that are the most beneficial. We don't need, even though industry keeps saying we don't need genetic engineering to feed the world. We have quite enough, and in fact, in terms of yield per acre, there are natural methods that are producing more yield per acre. The Food and Drug Administration, this is another myth, has not specifically reviewed one single genetically engineered food for safety. It relies on industry to do this. In other words, it lets the cat guard the hen house. Labeling does not increase food prices, and I've got some reference here for you if you want to follow that up. That is a myth of industry. To learn more about sources, I'm going to show you a couple of books that are, one of which is free online that you can get later. Okay, so consumers want labeling because they have concerns about health and safety. They have concerns about the environment. They have concerns about food security. Think of it for a minute. Biodiversity is the nature's great safety valve. It allows plants to survive under certain conditions, and then you collect the plants that are surviving under those conditions, and you keep planting those. We have, plants have this ability to change themselves, generally for the better, generally for survival. once you start a situation where just six companies, and it is just six companies now, and I can name them if you want, have control over all of the seed crops, then you have reduced that diversity, you reduce that safety valve for diversity. So concerns about food security. Also, over 60 countries, the majority of the countries in the world, including the European Union, require genetically engineered foods to be labeled. I mean, why not the United States? Why are we the only one in the modern world that doesn't let consumers know what they're buying?
That's right.
So, this is the back of my card, and I have larger copies of my card here, and you can take them, but it's very quickly the kinds of foods that may be genetically engineered. Corn in any form, the oil, the high fructose corn syrup and soft drinks and so forth, maltodextrin, soy, canola, and cottonseed in any form, including the oils. These are if they're not organic. If they're not organic, they're not supposed to be GMO. Beet sugar, and beet sugar is used more and more in things like high fructose corn syrup. Well, high fructose corn syrup is corn, but there's also beet sugar that's used a lot in prepared foods. It's beet sugar, by the way, is not the same as the beets in your garden. Yeah, I'll give you a little, whoops. Beet sugar here is not the name as the, it's not the same as the beets in your garden. It's a special kind of a white beet that's grown, just agriculture. It's not grown in people's home gardens. Milk and, 15% of the zucchini, that's small unless they're organic. Milk and dairy products from cows injected with hormones to make them produce more milk. Meat from animals fed genetically engineered food. So if you're confused, that's why we need labeling.
Yeah.
That's why we want labeling, because this is confusing. It's hard to remember it all, right? It took me a couple of years to remember. So, many states, including Illinois, many states, including Illinois, have introduced bills to require labeling of genetically engineered foods. Illinois is a big agricultural state. We did not have enough.
That's fine. You're good. Fine now.
We did not have enough votes in the Illinois General Assembly to bring it to the floor. But Vermont, little bitty Vermont, tough little Vermont. Vermont actually passed a mandatory labeling bill. It was signed into law, and it takes effect on July 1st of this year. Now we're getting into GMO 103. This is the, or 300 or whatever. This is the topic for tonight. Vermont is labeling. They will be labeling July 1st, unless something happens to stop them. And believe me, industry would like something to stop them, because they know that once people know about GMOs and the problems with them. And once they see those labels, they might be inclined to buy something else, and they're very worried about that. The producers of genetically engineered food want to stop this law from going into effect. So, what are they going to do? Well, they are taking all sorts of measures to keep consumers in the dark. And they even got a bill called the DART Act introduced into Congress. Now, that's not what industry called it. The industry called it the Safe and Accurate Genetic Engineer Labeling Bill, which is crazy. We call it DART Act because it stands for Deny Americans the Right to Know. D-A-R-K, boo. And it would stop states from requiring labeling without any assurance of federally required labeling. Usually when you stop states from labeling something, you have a strong federal law. The federal government passes a law, a standard for something, and they say, okay, that's the standard. The states are not going to be able to participate in anymore. It's called preemption. And they're trying to preempt the state bill, Vermont in particular. So, the most recent attempt to pass the DART Act was in the Senate on March 16th, so just days ago, basically. It was an attempt to pass what's called a cloture bill. Don't worry about what cloture is. It's just a way of saying it's a way to slip that bill through really fast without debate, just like the soap in your shower. Whoop, there it goes. And it, but fortunately, it needs 60 votes to pass, and they couldn't get the 60 votes. So people from all over the country, and the reason they didn't get those 60 votes, which they could have, is that people all over the country called their senators demanding clear, unpackaged, mandatory labeling of genetically engineered foods. So we won for now.
All right.
For now. For now. Okay, let's see what's next. Aha! That's the creature from the dark lagoon. Can you see him? It's a big kind of a reptile thing crawling out of the mud.
Oh, where'd this come from?
I got one in my back.
You got one in your backyard. It may be a Republican senator. Okay, the battle is not over. Industry still has some tricks to play, so we must be vigilant. And this is what we're going to be talking about right now. Okay.
The crocodile.
What are some of these deceptive proposals? Because the idea is to deceive you. One is education at taxpayer expense to allow companies to develop misleading one-sided information about genetically engineered foods. They go on and on with some of these myths of industry about how great they are, but you'd be paying your tax money for the government to give a message that was basically a totally industry-sided message. 800 numbers on packages that consumers would have to call to find out if their food was genetically engineered. How many of you have ever called an 800 number on a food package to find out something?
No.
Oh, good. You have. I have, too. I mean, I do it, too. I do it all the time. But most people don't, right? You got other things out here. You get your groceries home.
Are you sure they tell you the truth?
That's right. That's right. I mean, they know, and they know it. And they know it. The other thing that they're talking about is symbols that would leave consumers believing there was something beneficial for them in genetically engineered foods. But the most notorious one, this is the sneakiest deception. How many of you know what this thing is? Have you seen these on?
I have no idea. These
are called QR codes. And if you have a smartphone, you have to have a smartphone. You have to have an application on your smartphone to be able to read these. And then you have to be able to go to that website it takes you to and read what it says. So imagine that you're a mom with a lot of little kids running around and you're trying to get your shopping done and you're going to reach up for the package and you're going to pull the thing off and get out your smartphone and open up the app and read the code. No. And a lot of stores don't even have a signal that lets you do it anyway. So most people don't have it. Most people don't know how to use it. And it's hard for busy shoppers and moms. So QR codes let industry convey misleading messages to customers. You'd be getting the industry message, and it would capture information about you, conceivably, that industry could use. And, you know, we've talked about this, and we've talked to various people who are promoting this use of QR codes, and they said, well, most people who are shopping are young people, and they all have smartphones and know how to use them. How many people in this room have a smartphone? Okay, how many of you have a QR app on your smartphone? How many of you, if you wanted to, would be able to figure out how to download a QR app and use it on your smartphone? Yeah, okay, that's good. And then how many of you, when you went shopping and you're kind of busy, you're just trying to get through the store, would be taking packages down off the shelf and reading them with your smartphone application to read the QR code? Maybe not.
Yep. Yeah, what you'll be doing it was you're posting what you wanted to Facebook. So
yeah.
That everybody could update your status and just stop it.
Yeah, there you go. I mean, this is what they're talking about now. So, but it's not all bad news. Some good things are happening, too. The Seattle Times, there's been a lawsuit now against the Grocery Manufacturers Association for being deceptive in the money that they are taking from the food companies to defeat labeling. Now, why is it necessary for food companies to give money to their association? Well, the reason is that when we put out a list of the food companies that were spending money to defeat labeling efforts in various states, people started boycotting their foods, and those boycotts were effective. So the food company said, wait a second, we can't have this happen. So they gave the money to their association, the Grocery Manufacturers Association, let the Grocery Manufacturers Association do their dirty work. So this is kind of an interesting thing that they've been caught up before a court on this. Now, more and more companies now say they will label. The one company that is doing this the most responsibly is Campbell's Soup, and I don't have a slide up about it, but Campbell's Soup not only said they would label, but they would fight any efforts to stop mandatory labeling. In other words, they were taking our side. I'm not sure why, but they are. But the other companies here, General Mills, Tiny Vermont brings the food industry to its knees. Article, this is from the Washington Post. J. General Mills announced that it will start labeling genetically engineered foods. Now, do a little happy dance, but not too vigorous a happy dance, because we're going to learn a little more about this. Tiny Vermont is the first state to require such labeling, and that other state, well, basically, once Vermont passes the law, all the other companies have to follow suit. The U.S. Senate voted 48-49 Wednesday against a bill that would have blocked state laws. Nobody got the required 60. It was 60 that they had to get. That's what we won. We won that one. But let's see what's going on next. Okay, here is ConAgra, which makes all these different brands. I mean, I'm sure you know Slim Jim and Pam and Crunch and Munch and Peter Pan and Wesson Oil. And there are just 100 companies that ConAgra represents. They said they would start labeling to comply with Vermont law. Well, let's see in a second about that. Moving on, Kellogg's said they would start labeling, and you all know Kellogg's. They said they would label. So, here we have M&M's, Mars candies. It said they're going to start labeling in little tiny letters. Yeah, but here's the problem. Other companies are making similar announcements. A strong mandatory federal law is needed, but not until the Vermont law takes effect. And here's what we're all very worried about right now, for the next couple of weeks until July 1st. After the recess, this is their April recess, the Senate could still pass another bill that would go to a House conference committee, and they could rewrite the law any way they like. And once they did that, they could have a voluntary bill, and industry would say, well, we'll just do it if we feel like it. Yeah, we're going to do it if we feel like it this year, next year we don't feel like it. They could use QR codes, they could use any crazy kind of labeling, because that bill could be written so as to stop Vermont from enforcing its own law. Is this too complicated?
No.
Okay, all right. It's pretty complicated. Yeah, we want Vermont to be able to enforce its law, because if just one state has it, the whole country falls in line.
It's not complicated enough.
Huh? Not complicated enough, I'll make it more complicated. So, we don't want to allow any new legislation until the Vermont law is in effect July 1, and that's the big thing. So that's why I've got some info here for you. It takes like, how many of you have called a senator to say, please do this or that? All right, so we got a group here that does it. These are 2-minute calls. I've got the numbers here, I've got the script here, and basically it's just asking our two Illinois senators to support mandatory, clear, on-package labeling of genetically engineered foods, period. Mandatory means they have to do it. Clear means it's not this nonsense with the QR codes. On package means it's right on the package and not somewhere buried in a website labeling. Very, very simple. Okay, moving on. Please keep up the momentum. Now, who has cameras with them? Nobody has a camera? You have a camera. Well, then I won't dwell too much on the next screen. Because the next screen is something, if you want to, you can photograph that screen. But I also have that on a handout here, so don't worry about it. If you want to photograph it here, you can send it to your friends. And it's called your U.S. Senators, it's Senator Durbin, his number, Senator Kirk, your number. Is everybody here from Illinois?
Yes.
Okay. Two short messages. I want clear, unpackaged, mandatory labeling of engineered foods. I do not vote for any compromise that would keep Vermont labeling law from taking effect July 1. That's the message. And here are two books. This book, you can get online, and it's from a place called Earth Open Source. It's on my resource sheet where you can get it. This is free. This is free, and it's got a lot of good information. This is a book that you can ask your public library to get. It's very, very good. It's much more detailed about the legal stuff that went on, about how the Food and Drug Administration in 1992, I think I talked about this before, in 1992, the Food and Drug Administration prepared a long document about how genetically engineered foods would be released to the public because they would simply presume them all to be safe. I mean, there weren't even any genetically engineered foods at that point. They just presumed that they'd all be safe now and in the future. And senior scientists at the Food and Drug Administration said, you can't say that because we don't have that evidence. On the other hand, we have animal studies just like Dr. Kelsey looked at. We have animal studies that show some real problems. And until we resolve these, we don't want to just make the United States be 300 million guinea pigs. And they were overruled by the politicians who were of higher rank than the scientists were. So he explains a lot about that in this book. Now, what else do we have? I think that is the very end. I think we've just come to the end. Oh yeah, here's the brand new edition of GMO Myths and Truths. You can buy it on Amazon. Well, I guess I have a few copies in my car. Oh, I don't know if I brought a copy in here. Anyway, that's a good book, and that's the end. And I thank you for your kind attention.
Stay up there, take questions. Ram, why don't you,
questions. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Well, you mentioned Vermont passing this law. Are any other states close to passing a similar law, like California or anything?
Well, California, okay, here's what happened in the various states. California is one of the few states that has legislative initiatives, which are really like a popular referendum. We have it for certain things in Illinois. It's very hard to do, and it's only for very limited use. But California, as you know, probably know, allows it for a lot of things. We were running 60% for labeling in California. And then the very last minute, I mean the very last couple of days before the election, the industry made the most huge, I mean multi-million dollar television buys and just saturated the state with ads about how it would raise food prices and, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and a lot of the industry myths, and it went down by a small amount. Then the same thing basically happened in Washington and Colorado, which also have referenda. Laws passed in a couple of the New England states, Maine and Connecticut, but those states they didn't want to have to face the wrath of the food industry all by themselves. So they put in what were called trigger clauses. Trigger clauses mean that the law doesn't go into effect unless a certain number of other states also pass similar laws. So those expired, but they expired. Vermont's law passed, and now Vermont is being sued by the Grocery Manufacturers Association. That's still in court. It's one big thing, but the federal court has said, no, Vermont, the food industry tried to get an injunction to stop Vermont from going into enforcement. A federal court said, no, Vermont, you can go to enforcement, but you know we'll be considering the case, but not, we won't give you an emergency relief to stop enforcement now. Yes, sir.
We have a question. Once we get labeling on GMOs in Vermont, will it open the door for a hierarchy of labeling? In other words, Vermont just wants four words.
Yeah.
But can't that open the door? Shouldn't that open the door for a hierarchy of, well, what kind of GMO or GME is this?
Yeah, that's a good question.
Future.
And one of the really sticky issues here, and I don't want to go way into it because this gets really wonky, is that some of you have heard about the International Codex Rules that are defining food and drug laws so that all the countries will have the equivalent kinds of definitions for different kinds of foods. And there's a question about which kinds of foods get labeled. I mean, Vermont's law has a pretty widely used definition of what is genetically engineered. But you're saying something a little bit different about...
Well, once we open the door, you're only going to have four words as genetically modified.
Made with genetic engineering.
GMO, yeah. And then, but don't we want to know more information? Are there specific of GMOs that we want to know about? And
sure.
Certain hybrids that are bad? And that
well, wait a second. Don't get hybrids confused.
Not
that's,
hybrids.
Yeah.
You know what I mean. Genetically modified.
That's the thing. I mean, what I want myself is for, first of all, as Steve Drucker talks about in his book, which I can't seem to, I know where I need to go. Okay, sure, absolutely. I'll just answer this one thing. In Altered Genes, Twisted Truth, I've done it again. That book that was on there, and I'll try to get it back up there. He talks at length about what kinds of things the FDA has talked about in terms of labeling, and the information should be out there, that each one of those foods should be inspected individually, but the Food and Drug Administration is not doing that. They just have given a blanket thing, well, they're all okay, and they've left it to the industry.
They have no budget for it.
That's right, they have no budget for it, and that's a function of who wants them to have a budget. You're right. Right.
We don't have the tax money right. for it either.
Fred Costco and the lovely lady sitting next to it.
Oh, I was just going to say that if corporations have been so successful squashing labeling in all these other states, how did Vermont do it? And was that Bernie Sanders, or was it something that all states could copy?
Well, Bernie Sanders actually did, when the Farm Bill came up in 2012, he did introduce what was called the Sanders Amendment, which was terrific, which was basically an amendment to the Farm Bill that would say that the federal government could not preempt, could not stop states from labeling, and that didn't make it through. But I don't know that it was Bernie Sanders, but it was a lot of people, just like you and me and all of us, working very, very hard in Vermont, going to visit their legislators, talking to their legislators. I mean, I can't tell you how many trips I've made to Springfield on this thing, but you know, it's a smaller state, and they were able to, and also Vermont's not a big agriculture state. I mean, they're not growing a lot of corn and soy, which are the main GMO foods. So, and Vermont tends to be on the progressive side. So I think whatever happened, they got it. They got it. Now they're fighting, now they're being fought in court.
Okay, Janice? Janice?
Yes, I have a question. You know, it would be really fantastic if we got this labeling, but will that all change when the Trans-Pacific Partnership comes
through? Boy, yeah. This is another thing, and I do have a handout about that. You're absolutely right. How many of you have you had any people to discuss the Trans-Pacific Partnership here yet?
No, tell us.
Woohoo! Well, that's a whole other university course.
No. I'm just saying you're getting it's better in camera range there.
Okay. I hope you're using your wrinkle reduction lens. Is all I can say.
We are.
Not needed.
Right. Oh. Okay. Yeah. Okay. The president has just signed, but Congress has yet to ratify a trade deal that isn't really. It's really not a trade deal. It's basically an overarching system of laws that will outsource what Congress normally does to, in many areas about health and safety, to a group of trade representatives of many countries and representatives of major international corporations. And under that, we could wind up with provisions that would allow a company to look at our labeling law and say, well, that's restraint of trade. We're going to lose some of our profits if you put it there, so you've got to pay us that. An example of how that happened was, in a different kind of situation, Australia decided to put very strict warnings on its cigarette packages, and with pictures of people with lung cancer and so forth. And and Philip Morris, and Australia was part of a compact of several countries. I think it was Uruguay was in it, or one of the other countries. Philip Morris was also involved in that. And they sued Australia to say, Australia, if those labels stay on your cigarette packages, you will have to pay us from your tax dollars. Your taxpayers will have to pay us for the profits that we will estimate we have lost in cigarette sales in your country. Now, it looks like the courts may not have held that up, but it's been a long slog, and I don't know if that's over yet.
All right. Ileana Weinberg?
Okay, so I'm very skeptical about, pharmacy and about labeling. So my question is, how, if they label so many products, how people can be sure it's true? Just label and they're not even who under them. And my next question, what do you think about vegetarian food?
Okay, I'm going to go to the first one, and I'll do a little dance with the second one.
State the question first.
Okay, yeah. That, how do you know, even though they have a label that says non-GMO, how do you know that label's correct? Well, first of all, most of the states have some kind of an enforcement setup that, you know, some department is responsible. So if people have a question, they can take it, you know, in and say, let's test these things. Because like the non-GMO project, They actually test the food, and there are laboratory tests that can be done. So some of the states in their bills had what was called a private right of action, where you couldn't get money for it, but if you were a citizen and you felt that a company was cheating, and you could show that they were, then you could get an injunction against that company. And you couldn't get money for it, but it would be very embarrassing to that company to be called out like that. So the laws do have provisions in them to look at that. As far as what I think of vegetarian food, that's a different topic for a different time.
All right.
I'd like to know your thoughts on the food additive dihydrogen oxide.
Oh, boy. You know what? I don't have the additive list in front of me. Is that on the
dihydrogen oxide, H2O.
No, that's hydrogen. Okay, H2O.
Water.
H2O as an additive? Yeah, it's added all the time. It says water. I'm playing a joke. I think that's hydrogen dioxide. But anyway, don't.
No, there was a study out a while back where a bunch of people realized it was water, so yeah. Play on words.
Okay, go for it.
Wes Wagner, and then Mike Weiner.
Wagner. Are you familiar with the long-going struggle with the Monsanto company and what's going on in St. Louis?
Well, which one? There are a whole bunch of struggles going on. Monsanto is up to here with, suing farmers and, Monsanto is the major profit center for all of this.
Yeah, and they're based in St. Louis, and there's been a long going struggle there in St. Louis.
Yeah, when I drive to Springfield, it takes me about 3.5 hours. It takes about 1.5 hours for somebody to drive from St. Louis to Springfield, and believe me, they're there all the time. That's why it's important for you to keep in touch with your senators, because believe me, industry is all over. I spent 3.5 hours a couple of weeks ago with Senator Kirk's aide talking about this, and he was trotting out all these different people who'd been in to see him. He says, nobody's come in from your side of it. I said, yeah, because our side of it is all working people. Either we have jobs or we've got kids or whatever going on. The people who come in from industry to see you, they're all paid to come in.
I have a question.
I think I was done.
He's all right, Mike Weiner.
Okay. The first GEF was developed in 1982. I've heard that you're concerned about the labeling. You want the labeling to be done, but I haven't heard or read anything that points to any ecological impact, a negative ecological impact. I haven't seen anything that relates to health problems. I haven't seen anything that relates to the taste of the food or the texture of the food. So what's the big deal about labeling?
Sure, and very good question, because we courts don't allow labeling just out of curiosity. You're absolutely right. What happened in 1984, there were genetically engineered things being developed, organisms of various kinds, food, pharmaceuticals, whatever, in the development stages in the late 70s and the early 80s. But it wasn't really going to be a big money maker until 1984, when the Supreme Court decided that a genetically engineered bacteria could be patented. That's when the floodgates opened. That's when the cash register started ringing. And that was developed by Dr. Ananda Chakrabarty at the University of Illinois in Chicago. It was a very interesting gene of bacteria, actually. It was a bacteria that he developed that could eat oil. And the idea was that it could work to clean up oil spills. And that's a pretty neat idea, isn't it? I mean, I thought that sounded really great. It turned out the bacteria really didn't fulfill its promise. It really wasn't working well for that purpose. But the Supreme Court gave him the right to have a patent. And that changed everything. That's when companies, these were basically chemical companies selling chemicals, Monsanto and Dow and DuPont, started developing plants that could withstand applications of their toxic pesticides. And that's when things really opened up. And that's mainly what they're developed for now. What is wrong with them ecologically? And what is wrong with them in terms of health? First of all, I'm not going to go into it big deep, but on the back of this sheet, there are a whole lot of resources, primary resources that you can look at. The books that there are there that, this book right here, you can download this and you'll get a lot of information there. Primary, that has a huge, huge documented footnotes, primary sources that you can look at about the issues. So I really recommend it because it is free, it is online. Just go ahead and download it and search it to your heart's content. Now, as far as ecology goes, right now we are looking at huge amounts of glyphosate in our air and in our water. I mean, U.S. Geological Survey is documenting this. Glyphosate has been called a probable carcinogen by the WHO, the World Health Organization, and to make it even worse, Roundup contains not only glyphosate as its stated natural, stated active ingredient, but now we know, and I can send you, if you give me your company with your address on it, I'll send you a bunch of papers where it turns out that the so-called inert ingredients in Roundup are, in many cases, as toxic or even more toxic than the glyphosate itself, and that they increase the toxicity of the glyphosate 100,000 times. And to make it even worse, when industry does its experiments on animals, they experiment only with the active ingredient, which is glyphosate. They don't experiment with Roundup, so that the outcomes to the experimental animals are basically not as unfavorable as they would be if they used the actual Roundup that was being applied to our fields. That's just one product. The other thing is that a lot of this I know is about a pesticide glyphosate, but that is why most GMOs in the country, most plants that are genetically engineered to allow application of this weed killer glyphosate, except that now the weeds are becoming more immune, they're becoming more resistant, and so now industry has to move to something stronger. So now you have what's called the stacked combination that have glyphosate and 2,4-D resistance, so they're adding 2,4-D to this. Now, 2,4-D was one of the ingredients of the defoliant Agent Orange. It was admittedly, yes, the least toxic portion of Agent Orange, but it's still a major source of dioxin. The person who's really the expert on dioxin is the person who's supposed to speak to you tonight, and she would have talked to you about dioxin in the Great Lakes, because that's her area of expertise, Leanne Kasten, and she's a friend of mine, and I'm sorry that she's ill. So these two are really inextricably linked. But also, you know, we are learning a lot more about what goes on in the gene itself when you start to manipulate it. And part of the problem is that when industry does its testing, they only test out for 45 days. They don't do long-term testing, you know, long-term in the life of the rat or whatever animal they're using. Usually spray dolly rats industry uses, and others use them too. When scientists have carried out those experiments for a longer time, they start seeing some really big problems. So yes, there's enough there to say that if I had to make my personal choice between a GMO and a non-GMO product, I would rather choose the non-GMO product, just because the FDA has never really done its own testing and its own evaluation. They rely on industry, which profits from it. So these are all some reasons. And in fact, in a recent hearing before the U.S. Senate, the doc at the FDA testifying under oath before a Senate committee, and this is Dr. Susan Main, the head of nutrition, food safety and nutrition for the Food and Drug Administration. Okay. I have her title in my phone. She was asked by one of the senators, "Do you, the FDA, test for safety?" And the FDA person said, "No, we don't have the resources," like this gentleman pointed out. "We don't have the resources to do that. We leave it up to industry to do that. We ask them a lot of questions, but what they do is ultimately up to them." So these are all reasons that are concern to me. And if, you know, even if only 20 or 30% of the rats are having a problem, you know, I mean, how much, it's a matter of how much risk you're willing to take. I had a man come up to me at an event a couple of weeks ago, and he said, well, this is great, we should all be eating them. I take my grandchildren to the beach and let them eat sand. And I thought, well, okay. And he said, well, their mother doesn't let me do that. I said, okay. I wasn't good. I said, I can't argue with you, sir. You have a higher threshold for risk than I do. So I can't argue. I have no argument with you. Does that answer your question a little?
Sure it is. I came here to learn, and your response, I learned a lot.
Well, take this. And if you want me, you can write to me. And if actually, Carrie's address is on here, and Carrie's over here. If you write to me and you want this online, because it's easier to click on some of the links, you can do that too.
And Mike Lehman has been impatient.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
I met Sid Cohen.
Hi, Sid. Yeah. About Europe, you know, different countries in Europe.
Yeah.
Do they allow GMOs? Or
most of them do. There are very few countries that have a ban. The thing is that, the thing is that when people in Europe don't really want GMOs, and they don't buy them, so the American food companies, they're large international, but they're, you know, mostly American in nature, they make one kind of food for the U.S., another kind for Europe.
It's weird.
Mike?
One has to do with China and importing of food, and then the other question has to do with the corn and soybeans. Are you saying that like most food is corn and soybeans that goes to us or eventually gets to us and goes to livestock, you know, chickens and hogs and cattle? So is that, my question is the modification of corn and soybeans, is that basically where the problem is?
Corn and soybeans are the biggest crops. And here's the corn and soybeans go. Corn and soybeans grown in the United States, about 30%, don't hold me to these numbers because I don't have them in front of me, but about 30-ish% goes to biofuels, 28, 30, something like that. Another 30, 40% goes to feed animals. Only a small amount of that goes to humans, and that's generally in the form of things like oils and of like high fructose corn syrup and the additive kinds of things that like fillers and stuff like that.
So is that the top of the food chain where the problem really is the modification of corn and soy?
Well, the issue with the corn and the soy that goes, the stuff that goes, it's a really good question. The stuff that goes to biofuels, obviously we're not eating it, neither are the animals. The stuff that's going to the animals, they're eating the animals, and some of us are, they're feeding the animals, and some of us are eating those animals. But nevertheless, because these are grown to allow the use of toxic pesticides, especially herbicides, plant killing, weed killers, those are toxic. And so we're putting a lot more in our atmosphere, in our air, in our water. So even though we're not eating it, we're probably getting a pretty good dose of
pesticides and herbicides are another issue, but the GMO is
that's why they're modified. They're modified by the companies that were selling these things saw GMOs as a way to up their sales.
And not have to buy herbicides.
They could spray them on with an airplane and not have to put them on, you know, spot put them on.
All right, now I got a question about China. I'm really concerned because I heard that food will not have to even be labeled as
meat.
And I've heard like horror stories. They pump more antibiotics.
I know.
Chemicals into their animals.
I don't even want. That's a whole other night.
You didn't mention anything about that.
That's a whole other night.
Soon we're going to get all our food from China.
That's why Robin and Terry and I were just at the Good Food Festival, which at the University of Illinois, which celebrates our local farmers and our small farmers. So hopefully we can help them.
Robin,
Jan?
Yeah.
Now, one of the things that I didn't catch it if you mentioned it, but in addition to manipulating the seeds, they removed something in the seed that would cause it to germinate, and they put that in the fertilizer. So the seeds, if you buy the seeds from Monsanto, you also have to buy the fertilizer, otherwise they won't sprout.
Boy, do you know about this, Jerry? You know, there's the so-called...
It was a big issue. I think it was...
There's the Terminator gene.
Yeah. It was a big issue when Monsanto went into, I don't know, it was India or one of the countries over there. And the farmers over there had a big riot over it.
Okay, this is, it has to do with the cotton, because genetically engineered cotton, the only thing we eat, now I'm sticking to food here, but the only thing we eat of cotton is cottonseed oil. But obviously cotton's a huge crop, and most of it now is genetically engineered, unless you buy organic cotton. And in India, they were doing something with some of it called Terminator technology, so that the seed, you couldn't, the normal way that farmers get their seed every year is they plant their crops, and then they take some of the crops that, some of their crop, they take the seeds, and then instead of turning it into grain or something else, they keep that, that's your seeds for next year. Well, to keep that from happening, they put in this Terminator gene that kept the seeds from germinating, so the farmers couldn't do that. The other thing is that they don't do that, as far as I know, with corn and soybean, but on every, oh, another thing with the research that's a big problem, and this relates to it, on every package of seed, that of the big bags of seed for planting corn and soy, there's what's called a stewardship agreement. The stewardship agreement says that the farmer agrees that he will not use the seeds that grow from his crops, that he must buy them from the company. And Monsanto will sue any farmer that they think is doing that. The other thing is, as far as research goes, that one of the things on these stewardship agreements says that you're not allowed to use the seeds for research without the permission of the company that owns the seed, that owns the patent to the seed. So that scientists from various universities, they will go and they will say, you know, I want to do this research using your seeds, feeding them to animals or whatever. And the companies say, well, let's see your research protocol. And if it might show them up in a bad light, they'll say, you can't use our seeds. It was lucky that this French scientist, one of them, was one of the few people who was able to get a hold of seeds to use. And even then, the farmer he got them from may be in some trouble. Yes.
Charlie? So what exactly are the labels, right to know, going to say? I mean, let me explain. You just can't say what you want on a package. And I can't imply that my product is better than my friend Steve's if it isn't.
Most of
what will it say if you eat this food, this will happen?
No, it just is made with genetic engineering. Like, just like when you buy orange juice, it says made from concentrate. You know, and you decide, I want orange juice made from concentrate, or I don't want orange juice made from concentrate. Your choice.
And no hierarchy.
No, it just, you know, this is what...
Well, have there been follow-up things since I got here? Are any of the congressional, now we're talking about the Food and Drug Administration labeling issues, are any of this covered, like, on C-SPAN? Hearings that you know of?
Yes. Well, here's another thing. When you say the Food and Drug Administration, one of the things that this recent spate of legislation has done is to take this out of the Food and Drug Administration, which is our traditional place to study food safety, and trying to put it into the Department of Agriculture, which basically is about selling agricultural products. I mean, they do some safety things, but that's not their primary mission. But yes, there have been. There have been hearings. There was a hearing in the House. The House is pretty much a lost cause. But yes, this bill passed the House. That's why we're so concerned about the Senate. And there were huge hearings on it. And unfortunately, the leadership of a committee in Congress is going to be the party in power. The leadership is the Republican Party, which is more pro-industry in this respect. Okay, so when they choose, it's the leadership that chooses the witnesses. So when they choose the witnesses on either side, on industry side, they had some very strong witnesses. On the labeling side, they had some very poor witnesses who practically gave the store away.
Wes Wagger had a question before. You still have the question, or did you forget it? Wes?
Wes, are you late? I think he had some GMO food.
GMO. GMO ambulance.
Fermented GMO.
Corn barter.
Get your shot. Yeah, GMO shot.
From GMO corn bourbon.
That gentleman there has some.
Young man with a...
It's like brandy whiskey.
Jonathan Barton.
It's my understanding that one of the goals of Monsanto is to basically have patent and copyright all seed. Does that not violate some antitrust laws or the fairness doctrine?
Well, yeah, you know, I understand. I mean, this is six companies that are trying to basically own the world seed crop. And that bothers me in terms of biodiversity, in terms of food security, in terms of a whole bunch of different things. And that's one of the reasons that we want labeling so people can make
any
choices.
Chance you can name those six?
Yes, I can. As a matter of fact, here's, everybody know the initials BDSM?
No.
That have no meaning to anybody?
No.
Well, that's good. You're all good boys and girls. Okay, here you go, BDSM. We have Bayer, and we have Bayer and BASF. We have Dow and DuPont, although they may be merging into one company. I'm not sure how that's going to go. We have S is Syngenta and M is Monsanto. Six companies. BDSM.
How do you spell Syngenta?
I said Syngenta. S-Y-N-G-E-N-T-A.
Bayer, DuPont.
Check out the video when it comes out.
Bayer what?
What's the S?
Syngenta. S-Y-N-G-E-N-T-A.
Bill.
Has there been any documented case of anyone hurt, physically hurt, by eating genetically modified organisms?
Yes, absolutely. You can read about that in Altered Genes, Twisted Truth, and actually I knew that when it was happening. This is a very interesting. How many of you are interested in vitamin supplements?
Yeah.
Okay. There was a supplement being sold for a long time in the 80s and the 70s, 80s, 60s, 70s, 80s called L-tryptophan. It's one of the amino acids. People remember L-tryptophan, right? Okay. Do any of you remember that it went off the market for a while?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, let's talk about that. Here's what happened. In the late 80s, and I'm going to get these dates mixed up, I was there when it was all happening, and we didn't know what was going on. L-tryptophan, for those of you who don't know, helps you relax a little bit. Some people feel it helps them relax and get to sleep if they're having some sleep issues. Okay. And it was considered an amino acid, very safe. Suddenly, a bunch of people started dying and getting really, really sick. And nobody knew, you know, what the heck is going on. And, you know, CDC gets involved, they do epidemiological research, and they narrowed it down to these were people who had taken L-tryptophan from a certain company. And the company was a Japanese company called Showa Denko. And so they started doing some investigation about that. And what the FDA finally did, here is the thing, remember, this is in the late 80s, when they've already... When already something else has happened in the administration around the time of the first Bush administration, where the FDA was given two mandates. Number one, to do their traditional mandate, which was to guard the country's food and drug safety. But the other mandate, besides guarding health and safety, was to help promote the burgeoning biotech industry. That was the other mandate given to the Food and Drug Administration. So the Food and Drug Administration is asked to do something with this, and they investigated, and they came out with a thing saying there was something wrong in the manufacturing practice, and we don't know exactly what the problem was, but not only are we going to say no more L-tryptophan from Showa Denko or from any other country, we're just going to take L-tryptophan off the shelves. They took it off the shelves entirely. What came out many years later was this was a very early attempt in Japan to manufacture L-tryptophan with genetic engineering. I mean, this is really the first case that we know of. And people died, you know, so that was pretty dramatic.
Not that money, but the coincidence at that time was that's when Prozac was first marketed.
Yeah.
Like $5 a pill. Did the same thing.
Yeah. The second thing is, you know, the FDA, now at this time, I once had an afternoon with nothing to do, so I thought, I'm going to call up the FDA and see where I would report a case of illness due to genetic engineering, just see who will take my call. Because if it's with a drug or a food, right away there's a mechanism to put that into effect. I mean, zip, zip, zip. There didn't seem to be any way to report it. Well, if you don't look for something, you're not going to find it. So we really don't know. Now, we have animal experiments. We have some pretty scary things with animals. However, these are the same animals that are used to evaluate our pharmaceuticals, for instance, for safety before they're given to humans. Now, let me say this. What if I was going to be able to do a human experiment on health problems with genetically engineered food? And I told all of you, here's what the experiment's going to be. Half of you, you won't know which half you're in, but half of you are going to be in a long-term thing. You're going to eat the food I give you, and the other half is going to eat the food I give you, and half of your food is going to be genetically engineered, and the other half won't be. But you're not going to know the difference, and you're not even going to know what group you're in, and you're going to eat this food for about 5 years, because most of these problems are slow to build up that we see in the animals. How many of you would volunteer for this experiment?
Sure.
Okay, he'll volunteer. Great.
But does it pay?
Well, it'll be about at least 7 years. I've got one person out of about 25, 30 people.
It would depend on how much they pay.
Well, that's fine. Okay, I'm going to give you, I know it's a little, you'll have to come in for frequent testing, you know, blood testing and so forth. So I'm going to give you your lunch. You'll get free lunch when you come in. Well, how many of you will volunteer now?
Yeah, free lunch.
Not worth
okay.
my time.
I'm going to give you lunch and your car fare. Lunch and car fare. Come in. Okay. Lunch and car fare and $25. Good, I'm getting
it.
Okay. Do I make my point? You don't want to be in. It wouldn't be ethical to do this experiment, and you know it in your soul, in your gut. So what we know from animal studies is enough to say, let's not be the human guinea pigs on this. And until we really know for sure that something is safe. You know, another thing is, somebody has asked me, how do I know they're unsafe? About two or three questions. It is never, never, never the responsibility of individual consumers to show that something is unsafe. It's the function. We have laws in place in the Food and Drug Administration and so forth that say it's the function of the government to assure safety, and they have totally abdicated from that.
The government has no money to allocate to this. They do not have the money to hire professional people to do the work. So if they don't have the money, don't sit there and yell at them.
No. I'm not yelling at them. What I'm saying is I want the ability to make the choice myself.
You got competition.
Since you're right, since they don't have the money, and they're not going to do it.
So we have to figure out how to give them the money.
That we could figure out how to give them the money.
Yeah, I can tell you exactly how to give them the money.
How would you do it?
The first thing I would do is pull 300 military bases out of foreign countries.
There you go. Yeah. And
that would be $7 billion a month out of Dick Cheney's pocket into the taxpayer.
And I want you speaking
up. You know what $7 billion will do for the FDA? It'll get them a lot of people.
Yeah.
However, let me say this,
next thing I would do is legalize all drugs.
But before that money gets to the FDA, you've got to get the authorization for it, and that means you've got to get it through a very, very difficult political.
What you don't understand, Bernie Sanders has been working with the system for 40 years. Gus Ratty is not going to even spend a day working with the system.
Okay.
He's going to tell you what his vision is.
All right, what we're going
to
do.
And I will get my voice down.
Time out. This is a question period. In a few minutes, we're going to have rebuttals. You're going to be able to give your full rantings and ravings in a 5-minute
time. But your point is very...
I apologize.
Don't worry about it.
What is your name?
My name is Gus Roddy.
Right. We thank you for your passion.
I'm a Catholic.
We thank you for your passion.
I'm not going to argue with you. What I'm saying is that's why we need labeling, though. So people, if the FDA isn't going to do it, we got to do it for ourselves. Okay. And that's what a label does.
What you don't understand, lady, is that the FDA would be more than happy to do it, but they have no money.
I understand.
What you have to understand is that we don't bitch and moan about the fact that they aren't labeling anything. What we do is we give them the money so that they can hire people, so that they can do peace and love to all.
In my lifetime, I wish in my lifetime.
All right, I think we're done with questions. I guess
we're done.
Let's go to rebuttals.
Is it time for that?
Close enough.
Now the system is, how many people here have remarks to make to the rest of us? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
All right.
And probably somebody else will be inspired.
All right, before we go to rebuttals, let us thank our speaker.
About 5 minutes each for the speaker.
All right, let us thank our speaker. And the spiel get the final word. All right, let's get the back. Let's
I have no fight with you. I have no argument with you.
Give me a minute. We'll take 5 minutes each for each rebuttal, and we're going to have to pull the podium.
All right.
This is cool. What's your
song? He's got a smart. He's got a microphone. Thank you.
I'm
going to
have you on with me.
All right.
Yep, everybody's going right. through here.
Fun.
We will have a computer available if you want to get the website.
We have two rules here. One is that we don't insult anybody here personally or their parents. The other is one fool at a time so the rest of us can hear what's going on.
All right, you're good to go. 5 minutes.
All right.
Abraham Lincoln is quoting as saying, let the people know the truth and the country will be safe. No. So I'm starting that with thoughts in my head about this topic. Recently, about 3 months ago, I went to my local grocery store and I was just going through the vegetable section and I found this curious area way in the corner that had Brussels sprouts in this plastic container. Absolutely no words, no contact information, nothing. Completely unlabeled on the package. And I'll tell you the honest truth, it's sad to say this, but I wasn't shocked. Because of all the information that you just provided us, so how many different people at different levels of power, influence, and wealth in this country are in the pocket of the genetically engineered food industry, as you told us, it's not GMO anymore, it's genetically engineered food. So I spoke to the manager, and it was a very, very enlightening conversation with someone who obviously had been well trained by the Grocers of America Association, if I'm paraphrasing it correctly. He said, oh no, they're completely labeled. And I said, well, here's a piece of plastic, basically, and the product in the plastic. So, where's the label?
Right.
He was obviously, kind of confused why someone would actually bother the time to ask this question. And then he walked back to the area of the vegetable section. And he, maybe was buying himself some time, or he had to call somebody quick to get the exact line on this. What do you say to a concerned consumer who actually, expects transparency? So he came back to me with a nice smile and he says, oh, the label's on the shelf.
Yeah, right.
And I said, well, I'm not purchasing a shelf today. I want to purchase some vegetables, and I'd like to know how much these Brussels sprouts companies information are they going to share with the public in the future, not just about me and my individual purchase, but I wasn't impatient or rude to him. I was very, very tactful because I knew he was trying to goad me into exactly that. And he said, this isn't a conspiracy. Look, I know you're concerned, but obviously it's a reputable company. And I told him, hey, this is a serious matter, and you're right. It's not a conspiracy.
you're doing it right out in the open. Yeah, to me, that's not a characteristic of a bad or dishonest grocer. That's a cartel. That's an endgame strategy. When you're talking about patenting all foods, that's a cartel response. That's a characteristic of something that's a little bit more serious to me than just a grocer that doesn't know an answer to my question.
Right.
I was reading my dad's notebook from University of Illinois in the 60s when he wrote, he was a physics student. He said, the kinetic energy of emitted electrons is directly proportional to the frequency of light that frees them. The kinetic energy of emitted electrons is directly proportional to the frequency of light that frees them. And I was thinking, how do I relate this to that topic? Well, we the people's understanding and participation in democracy is directly proportional to the amount of information, ideas, and history on which the light of the media shines. And I just want to say, you know, ignorance is being unleashed on us by plutocratic media outlets, fundamentalist groups, or some would say cults, corporatist legislators, pro-market think tanks, pro-1% educational institutions, public relations firms, privatization proponents, wealthy lobbyists, CEOs, legal teams, pundits, and various other groups that profit off this propaganda. And I used to think, oh, it's just the media, you know, they have a freer media in Europe or other parts of the industrialized world. But the onus is on we the people to seek out that media and to demand that the corporate media no longer be as powerful as it is by just turning it off and not supporting it. And, you know, buying newspapers and magazines that represent we the people's idea of what democracy is. So I think it's a big issue of informing the people by the people demanding that corporate media no longer be used and community media being the norm that we receive our information from. So I thank the speaker very much for being here today.
The book to read on regulation is Gabriel Kunkel, The Triumph of Conservatism. And the idea is that the progressive revolution that happened about 100 years ago, getting all these regulatory agencies in, was not a populist uprising, but an effort by the very same supposedly targets of this regulation. It was their idea to enforce a cartel, or whatever cartels. It's been 30 years at least since I read the book. I can't remember that well, but I can see two possible objects of regulation. One is to enforce a cartel, or which is what I got against unions, since labor unions are a labor cartel.
That's good.
And the other one is to enforce a contract. I mean, if you want to, it takes a certain amount of knowledge on each side to make it a valid contract. Now, would you like to get a cab in the middle of the night without knowing anything about the cabbie?
It's okay.
The chauffeur's license regulations at least give you some security in that regard. But 30 years ago, I thought basically that one % enforce their regulations or their ideas was through inflation, taxation, and regulation. Well, I'll modify that now to say that regulation does have a proper function if it is to enforce contracts. And if there's all this resistance to labeling, well, I've never heard of a genetic modifying company being run out of business, but I think they're very much against having to enforce a contract.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Next. Next.
Sid Cohen. Thank you, Bill.
Sid Cohen.
Okay.
5 minutes, Sid.
Okay.
You got plenty of time, so if you go over a little bit, it's okay.
Yeah.
5 minutes.
Now, Sid.
When I was a kid, I started exercising with the weights, and I used to get these magazines. One of them was called Strength and Health, another was called Iron Man, and what they had in there, they talked a lot about natural nutrition, that if you want to eat something, don't buy it in a can, don't buy it in a box, unless of course you can't get it any other way, and make most of your foods yourself and eat natural foods. I remember I used to go to the fruit store and you would get a peach, but you'd have to cut it open because a lot of them contained worms in it. Because there was no additives and there was no pesticides put on these things. And that's the way food was sold and that's the way I was taught to eat, by reading these magazines. But nowadays you go in the store, let's say you buy meat is full of steroids and things to make it grow. If you drink milk, which I don't, it also has additives with it, and they try to get as much milk as possible by feeding it hormones and so forth and so on. And this is the type of thing that we have. Of course, at that time, you didn't have these humongous corporations, where now I think you have 3 or 4 big corporations that produce and sell all our foods for the most part. So when you have these corporations, of course, what they try to do is maximize their profit levels. And of course, with the GMOs, what they're trying to do is maximize their profit levels as much as they can get out of it. They don't particularly care whether or not people get sick or not. That is very secondary. But the main thing is, under our system of so-called free enterprise or capitalism, is to maximize the profit. And they'll do that any way they can. Unless, of course, there's reaction against it, where people get together and protest against it and have organized protests against it, and then they may be cut back to a certain degree, but then you get the same thing again, over and over and over again. So that's the type of economic system we have, and if you want to get away from it, of course, you have to go to a higher economic system in order to develop something that for the need of the people, or people get healthy and so forth. I just recently seen the movie with Michael Moore about Invade Me, and he shows different things. Like in Norway, he's showing how these kids have their food for lunch and so forth. And then he showed another picture of food in the United States, the schools, and what they give them for lunch. It was complete opposite. It was mostly junk food in the United States, and it was healthy food in Norway. So I think the only way we get away from that probably is by going to a different economic system. Really.
Socialism.
Yep. Socialism.
How much time do I get?
5 minutes, bro. 5 minutes.
5 minutes. All right, let me see that clear to zero. All right, folks. I am so thrilled to be here. You just don't know how thrilled.
Welcome, guys. Welcome.
Especially. This is a presidential platform. I'm going to tell it to you real quick.
Uh-oh.
I will. Point number one, legalize drugs.
Yes.
No.
Legalizing drugs will kill a number of birds with one stone. Yay. It is also a money maker. Just as we legalized alcohol in 1933, we will tax the living daylights out of heroin, amphetamines, cocaine, etc., etc., and create a solid source of financing for the U.S. government.
As the price of these drugs drop astronomically, the strong-arm gang war tactics on the south side of Chicago, to name a typical urban area, will disappear because the money involved in controlling these black markets has disappeared. The drug dealer's business has disappeared, and much like Al Capone back in the day, the drug dealer will have to find another job.
Oh.
Heroin will be available at the local Walgreens for $5 a pop.
Oh, no.
Of course, just as we control the use of alcohol, so we will control the use of hallucinatory drugs.
Oh, no.
But the money will no longer be there. You understand it? Another point worth mentioning is the fact that all the Colombian farmers growing poppy because the price is so much better than maize, we'll have to return to earlier strategies of growing foodstuffs and other plants because poppy simply pulls a much lower price when it is legal and taxed than when it is illegal. Are you with me?
No.
Are you with me? This is not rocket science! Point number two, we pull 300 military bases out of foreign countries. We have 800 military bases in foreign countries. Ever since World War II, the U.S. has been in the business of policing the planet in the hope that only governments with the interest of the U.S. in mind will be allowed to flourish. This is a crazy notion. I would pull 300 military bases out of all first world countries and quite a few third world countries.
Yeah.
The fact that we have bases in first world countries should be a red flag.
Yeah.
How would you like it if Germany established a military base in the school across the street from your house?
No.
What do you think your government has been doing for 70 years?
Whoa.
Now, I'm going to calm down, all right, because I don't want to rip this microphone off his hand. I should say at this point that both of these bullets I mentioned, legalizing drugs and pulling 300 military bases out of foreign countries, are money makers. The U.S. government pays Halliburton $7 billion a month to supply and equip all the soldiers we have in foreign countries. It is worth mentioning that Dick Cheney, bless his wonderful heart, is CEO of Halliburton. I'm not gonna go there. So that is $7 billion a month in the taxpayers' pockets. Along with who knows how much in sin taxes as a result of taxing heroin, cocaine, amphetamines, etc., etc. Next point. 10% income tax on all entities. How am I doing for time?
One minute left.
10% income tax on all entities, corporate and personal. I am a registered piano technician. I set aside 15% of whatever I make for the federal government. The 10% would allow small businesses like myself a much bigger cushion to deal with the ups and downs of small business. The corporations would just have to bite the bullet and pay up. Individuals wouldn't see much difference. Bullet number four, Connecticut gun control laws to be made federal law. To purchase a firearm in Connecticut, an interview with a sheriff is required. On that basis alone, gun crime in Connecticut has dropped by 40%. If we make this law federal, the combination of legalizing drugs and requiring an interview with a sheriff will put a serious dent in the gun crime problem in the U.S. It would also start depopulating the prison system in the U.S. as a source of a good percentage of the population in the jails of the U.S. are young black males with few options. Are you with me?
Let them out.
I hope I'm
I'm scaring you by now. Bullet number five, wrapping it up.
Sit down.
People before profit. This is not a specific point. This is the principle by which my administration will operate. It is our modus operandi, if you will. I will make sure that my administration understands the meaning of these words in the context of their specific task within the government. They will be given a lot of responsibility. I will sit down with them once a week to talk about what happened the previous week and what our goals are for the next week. After that, they will be functionally independent. Vote for this platform. Don't vote for me. I may let you down. But if this platform is in place, the people will be found.
Okay, when you're ready.
GMOs and smoking. How many are hooked here?
What?
For the cigarettes.
I used to be.
A few. All I can say is we're at the beginning for GMOs, and that's what we did with cigarettes years ago. And it took how many years for us to back off on cigarettes? How long is it going to take this time? How much longer is it going to take us to back up GMOs? What you say here is we need to get it right away. And the people who need to hear this are the kids. A bunch of old, what are they going to be around? The kids are going to be around. We're not. These are a few things to think. I get something called the Sun Magazine. As Bill Watterson said, in my opinion, we don't devote enough scientific research to find the cure for jerks. When birds and books disagree, always believe the bird. James Audubon.
All right. Yeah, my turn. My turn. My turn.
Time's up.
All right, my friend. You're advocating a closure of all military bases.
No.
A closure of all foreign military bases.
I did not say that.
Okay. A closure of all foreign military
bases. I did not say that.
300.
Okay.
I said 300 out of 800.
Okay.
That's a good start.
Overseas bases.
The thing is that if the United States withdraws its presence from the world, it will be a much darker place.
Bullshit!
Our greatest export in the world is keeping the sea lanes open and the goods a-flowing. I only say this because over the next 100 years, I believe the United States is going to play a central part in what the world does and the world affairs. And we're going to probably have a more peaceful world under the, quote, empire of the United States with Pax Americana than we would if we let and withdrew. Because if we don't take responsibility for, quote, this world empire, somebody else will, and we may not like what you need to see. Now, as far as drug legalization is concerned, most of the time I'm in favor of it. People do have a right to be stupid. And, you know, if some major corporations can get into the legality of getting people, making people stupid and getting them hooked on this stuff, maybe that's what we need to do. Because
you do it in a controlled environment.
One pool at a time.
Yeah, who defines control? Whether it be Philip Morris or your local Whole Foods store, you know? Yeah, we can see it already. The big thing is...
Flint, Michigan.
Huh?
No, Flint, Michigan.
Flint, Michigan. That was a That was a disgrace. The government entity's not doing their job in a complete denial of responsibility. Basically, it's like this. If the United States takes its role in global security seriously and partners with people, and we stop acting like 17-year-olds as a nation and grow up, I think we'll see a much better world. No, it's not withdrawing our power. It's using it much more responsibly, much more sensibly, pairing with international organizations, strengthening the UN, and doing what needs to be required to bring world peace.
Yeah. I would take that as a card.
You can rebut. And if, yeah, if we got other speakers.
Well, right now I have the floor.
Rebut. Let's get up there. Next.
I want to go back up there.
I don't know if it's really useful.
Oh, it will be useful. All right, Brahm.
The first person's plural. We, our. It's not our government. We don't own it. We don't control it. We have minimal input into what it does. And that's not just because we are anonymous people here. It's because in this world, position, money, and other things control the government, what we call the government. Sometimes it's called establishment. And people are very jealous for their position with the establishment or whatever connections they may have with the establishment, because that's their security. That's their way of dealing with the world. So when we talk about a democratic social revolution, you have to weigh what kind of power people have, what kind of weight you can give to a movement, what kind of experience people will have when they're transforming their world. You have to look for what the possibilities are, and that's reshaping the world much more than not buying genetically modified foods. But that's a start.
Somebody goes next. Who wants to go next?
Who is our next speaker?
Well, open mic.
Oh my goodness. Well, all right, if that's it.
No, there's got to be more. Who's going?
I don't really see the point of a rebuttal. But
no, you don't get two shots.
Let me say a few words.
You don't get two bites at the apple. No. Adios, one bite.
I told you.
No. You only give me $3, perhaps. No, we really don't allow two bites. All right, I just wanted to thank Joan and the Illinois Rockville people for coming on relatively short notice due to the illness of our regularly scheduled speaker. It's good to see you again. Good that you're keeping the efforts up on behalf of the consumers in the United States. It's an important issue what the labels on our products actually must say, tell the truth. There must be accuracy to the best that we know it objectively. And that's obviously not to be subject to influence. Everyone knows about unmet product claims. We get that in advertising wherever we go. Is the product claim that it's new and improved when it, in fact, is not new and improved? The other day I bought a toaster and I was looking at the box and it said it was going to do this and that and a few other things, which it almost did, but it didn't quite, it wasn't quite as accurate as was depicted on the literature on the box. This is an important thing. If you have legitimate evidence that GMOs are harmful, in fact, to people, present this to the agency that deals with regulating food. I'm a very lazy person. I rely on the government when I get medicine that, in fact, if I take that substance, that will be good for my health. And the same thing when I go to the grocery store, when I buy a product and they say that this is nutritional, has nutritional value, I can rely on the government in that regard. I'm a federal employee and I have a bias towards agencies. That where it is. If they've been corrupted in some fashion, are they immune? I don't know. That particular agency, are they above the fray? But that's where our responsible government lies. I get a regular update of regulations issued by the federal government on all sorts of areas, and I'm intrigued to hear the Republicans running for president, and to show you where you're at in your lobbying effort, every single one of them says in the first day of office, I'm going to get rid of all government regulations. And the audiences, the groups would cheer, yay, isn't this wonderful, this is our guy. And then you come along and say, well, we want government regulations. Well, we can't have it both ways. And understandably, free market capitalism, which is entirely profit-driven, is opposed to any or all regulatory efforts in this regard. But hopefully we'll see what turns on this. Maybe you still have got time. You've got another year. There's a lot of issues out there, but try as best we can. I didn't succeed on some issues. But if you can make this an issue for the campaign, I think that would be a wonderful thing to achieve. But thank you again for coming on such short notice and for all your good work. And I gave you a dollar too. Thank you. All right. By the way, our waitress, wherever she is, you know, it's a holiday, Easter, you know. Maybe the rabbit will Easter egg, give her a little, you know, a little Easter gift. Yeah. Remember our waitress. All right, thank you.
I've got a bunch of literature up here. Thank you very much. I've got a bunch of literature up here if anybody wants it.
Okay.
It's here for you. It has some on the TPP, some on the science stuff. Just stuff up here if you want it.
Okay, we still have an open mic. Whoever has desire to speak. Go ahead.
Come on. All right. Where's that guy?
Oh, he's coming. Whoever's got a chance, we have an open mic. Come on, we have an open mic. We have an open mic.
No, yeah. Give him the microphone.
Is that it, then?
I don't know if that's it, but Andy. All right, Andy. All right. Oh, Andy. Hey, Andy.
L.P. Anderson.
Oh, my God. Hello. Hello. Is the mic on?
Yes, it is.
We hear you.
Okay. Sorry I didn't hear the talk tonight. My car got towed earlier by a towing company that's running a scam out in the western suburbs. So it's another thing like the red light cameras. If you've been paying attention to newspaper articles, they're finally figuring out that the red light cameras aren't red light cameras. They're rolling tire cameras that are for revenue enhancement. And so those, and also the new studies are showing those cameras aren't in any intersections where you need to control traffic or safety or anything else. The cameras are in safe areas where they're taking money off drivers driving safely, where they're like the classics. You see a lot of these cameras in the entrance to upscale shopping centers. You fade off the highway into the right-hand lane and you're stopped and getting ready to turn in to go to something like Walmart or Deer Park. The entrance to a shopping center, not a cross street with traffic, but the entrance. There should be a billboard there that says, if you got enough money to shop here, give us $100 for the village. And we'll split it with the red light camera company. So it's taken several years for the newspaper articles, people to begin to print this stuff. But we're seeing these giant scams left over from 2008. I don't know if all of you are aware of a website called Common Dreams, but that's one of my favorites. They post the best of the best news every day, and then it goes viral. There's been a spate of articles in the last few days talking about voter fraud and voter suppression in the Democratic Party. They are currently running a complete, media is running as perfect a total blackout on Bernie Sanders as it is possible to run. And they're massaging the vote totals and disenfranchising voters, closing polling places to keep the Democratic vote down for Bernie. Because he's talking about issues that make a difference to Americans. For those of you that have not seen the schedule, we have Dennis Nelson is going to give a tremendous speech. I think it's the 23rd here on Earth Day. We have Earth Day speakers. I'll be giving a talk on the 30th on the state of the art, a summary of all the global warming knowledge that's out there. James Hansen from NASA just put out a new, talking about a new report that came out last week saying the ice and the sea level rise is happening faster than anybody thought. And they thought that it was going to be over a scale of maybe 100 years. Now they're talking about a scale of decades. They said there's a very real possibility that we can have a 15 feet sea level rise by 2060, if we continue burning fossil fuels at the rate and we continue not doing anything. They're calling for like a Manhattan Project, what we did in World War II, where industry mobilized, and they mobilized to build something to put an end to the war. Well, that's what we need, like a moonshot program or Manhattan Project on global warming. So if anybody tells you that the science of global warming is not solid, it is still in doubt, or like the libertarians that come here every now and then say, we've all been misled. 10 years from now, it'll be all a hoax. We have to get the language right. These people are lying to us. The media people, they're not making mistakes. They're flat out lying to us. When they print the, they talk about in this country unemployment being at 5.8% or something. That's a huge bald-faced lie. Half the people in this country either unemployed, underemployed, or scraping by on two jobs or something. There's 213 million adults that need a full-time job in America, and there's only 106 million registered full-time jobs in America. The rest are part-time, crappy jobs, or people when they quit looking for work and they drop off the unemployment rolls and everything, they're not counted as unemployed anymore. Bernie is talking about all these issues, and that's why the media is running the smoothest, best coordinated, seamless blackout of any politician in the history of this country. Nobody alive today has ever seen anything like this. So it's up to all of us to help our friends, neighbors, relatives learn, you know, stop trying to watch the news and start logging on to some of these websites that tell us what's really, really happening. The website called truthout.org has huge archives of environmental issues, you know, all kinds of pollution, water, air pollution, Incidentally, did you, anybody hear in the news this last week for the first time the polls show that an overwhelming majority of Americans, something above 60%, are opposed to the use of nuclear power? The public is the majority. We passed the tipping point in this country, and other countries are up near 80 or 90% of their people opposing nuclear power.
What about thorium, though? What about thorium?
Yeah, thorium is nuclear power. Wasting money on thorium is wasting money that could be used. Any kind of nuclear power is a total waste of money right now with what we're looking at in climate change. So we have to get real. And help our less informed friends, neighbors, and relatives come out of the bubble of mythology they've been living in and face reality. Incidentally, there's a new, for those of you that haven't seen it, how something that's real, how people can ignore something that's right in front of their face for years, is the movie Spotlight, talking about the Catholic priest problem. They ignored that for years. Well, the people that promote the idea that nuclear power is usable, they're in the same bubble of mythology that the Catholic Church was covering it up for years until the reality got so big that you can't ignore it anymore. So Bernie is the, well, we got time.
Next speaker, come on.
In the bubble, man.
GMOs. Okay.
There's all kinds of bubbles. You wait. Okay. Thank you, and come to the talks in April. We'll have information on April 30th. I'm going to bring in at least 30 books, free books on environmental and social issues. Everybody can walk away. Everybody that shows up that night can walk away with a free book.
All right.
Down with GMOs.
Yeah, right.
Mike Levin.
It was a very informative speech here tonight, speaker. I wanted to bring up something a little bit different. The GMO is one issue, and then all these additives and other sides, herbicides, pesticides, is other things, and then the antibiotics are another issue. The antibiotics that go into animals that you ate tonight were given to animals that we eat because they live in really terrible conditions, unhealthy conditions. So they feed them a lot of antibiotics so they don't get diseased and die, and they can get fattened up and produce more meat. So there's a whole bunch of issues when it comes to food. And of course I'm concerned about the quality of Chinese food now that we're going to be importing all our food from China, which sounds crazy. So now I gotta, here's the issue I wanted to bring up, because not Chinese.
Start regulating Chinese.
Chinese from China.
That's a money thing.
With poison in it
all night.
It's got all kind of, if you look up the research on what China puts into their.
We're like an eating chow mein.
Poison.
It's terrible. We're going to get more and more of it. Even I just saw, I always like to get.
How
these
come they did so well with the Transcontinental Railroad then? The Chinese.
What?
How come they did so well when they built the Transcontinental Railroad?
Well, that's fine, but when they're, when they're feeding all this junk to animals and then we're eating it. All right, so you saw Jolly Green China. The damn Brussels sprouts are coming from China. What the hell's that all about? Anyway, I have a question. If, and this has to do with GMOs and whole food markets. So why is whole food so expensive? Is it just to rip off the public or the rich people?
Duh.
Why do I go to Whole Foods and it's double the cost
why
of everything else, and supposedly they're not putting all this crap into the food that Whole Foods sells?
Because you're a sucker.
Yeah.
So is there a business
called Whole Paycheck?
So yeah, Whole Paycheck, Whole Food. So why if the general public is eating all this food with antibiotics and chemicals and pesticides and all this other crap in it, and we're being poisoned, and then Whole Foods is selling product that doesn't have any of that stuff in it. Why is Whole Foods so expensive? Because they're just selling stuff that doesn't have it. Or is Whole Foods tricking us and they're not really quite as organic as we think they are? And what does Whole Foods have? Do they have non-GMO products in Whole Foods? Do they have non-antibiotic foods in foods? Do they have non-herbicide pesticide? Or is it like a game? Is it a tricky, you know, gotcha thing? So, if you could address that, you're coming up here to speak again. So what is the Whole Foods scam? Maybe you could bust them right now.
All right, Max.
We're supposed to be here for 9 o'clock.
He said forget 9 o'clock. He wants to unplug us in 5 minutes.
No.
First of all, the last speaker asked why he went to Whole Foods. Well, why do you?
What time is it, Timmy?
It's 8:17.
Why am I going to the
second? I don't always agree with Andy, but on the subject of nuclear power, I certainly do. As I've said several times before, I'm old enough to remember when Commonwealth Edison built the nuclear plant in Zion. I was living in Evanston then, and I was in high school at the time. And Commonwealth Edison promised years and years of cheap electricity on all these commercials that they showed on television. And some of you will remember with the cartoon figure of a light bulb known as Little Bill.
Yeah.
Well, what happened to all the cheap electricity, folks? And on top of that, Zion is now closed and it's in the process of being decommissioned. So much for cheap electricity. Thank you.
All right. I'm gonna. This deserves a rebuttal.
Gus.
Go, Gus. Go. You go.
We want.
You gotta ask. Is everybody done?
All right, Gus. Take your second round.
Yeah.
All right.
Here we go.
All right. Rev him up, Gus.
Smile. Buy him a beer. Maybe they'll mellow out.
Because
right now, they want my
ball. Buy him a beer.
All right, folks.
All right, let's go.
My understanding, then, is that your position is that we are responsible to maintaining a secure, stable environment for
the
trade
world
to be conducted and so forth, etc.
It's what we're doing now.
What we're doing now.
To a certain extent. We are an empire whether we like it or not, and we better admit that we are. Because if it's just not
now, I'm going to propose, I really have to think about it, and I need this, because this is the kind of stuff I'm going to get hit with.
See, the thing is, you got to remember, the United States is the world domination empire. We've been that way since about 19, and since the end of the Cold War. And whether
the
we like
the Cold War?
Since the end of the Cold War.
Which was 89?
89-90. Now we've been the world.
89-90. Russia went kaput, and we really had no big
boy. We had no big boy empires. We've been the dominant. We are the largest economy in the world. We have access to both the Atlantic and the Pacific, and we're larger than the next 7 economies combined. When you take a look at that, and with the projection that we're still one of the most stable countries in the world, and any time the United States even sneezes, the rest of the world takes notice. We have a slight recession, China goes ballistic because half of their trade relies on us.
All right, now, I thought I was up here.
I thought so, too.
Because I was going to do the talking.
Okay. You're right. One fool at a time. So
but please. If that's not the case,
you're right.
Then I stand corrected.
No.
Go ahead, Gus.
Go ahead, Gus. I'm sorry. I'm passionate like you are. My apologies. Let's reset the clock.
I do this all the time.
Well, I'm just trying to get my thoughts together here. My basic position is that when we assume that we are responsible for the stability, security, et cetera, of the planet, that we are the policemen of the world. We're assuming a position that is unsustainable in the same way that a farmer cannot grow without seed. Because you're in a situation where you're trying to control an environment where you are only residing in, what is the United States? 1/10 of the entire planet, if that. So you are trying to control the environment of the entire planet from this portion of the land, and your interests are being superimposed upon the interests of all these other countries, and you're telling me this is a viable way to go. I think that's horse shit, quite effectively. I think that you will constantly be up against it, and you will never be in a place of peace because you are basically shafting everybody else in your own interest, and it doesn't work. I mean, Gandhi with India and Britain was the last classic, a very clear example of a man effectively getting results as non-violently as he possibly could. Getting independence. Now, God knows India is totally screwed up with that independence. They, you know, they're like all the rest of us. They're having a hard time, you know. But they have choices. They choose their own suffering. Whereas before, Britain gave them their suffering. In the same way, Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan, I don't know who the else there is. There's literally zillions of these little countries that we are superimposing our wills upon, and we are planting military bases in, and it's an unsustainable situation. And I don't know, I gotta learn how to not raise my voice, no, because I'm much more effective.
You're keep it up, you're fine.
If I just communicate from a place of peace and just drill you. But
violence.
Oh, you're good.
Maybe it works, you know, to get a little excited.
It does.
You think a little theater is appropriate?
Like
of course.
I mean, Fidel used a little theater. Fidel was amazing. He could go for 5 hours and keep people totally hooked. For five, I mean, right through the night. That's talent, man. I don't think I have that kind of talent. But I will tell you this. I'm running for president. I want your vote. Now, I tell you, the platform wants your vote. I don't want your vote because God knows I'm Gus Ratty and I'm a pretty pitiful creature in a lot of ways. I like women way too much. You think Bill Clinton's bad. I mean, we don't want to go there. All I'm saying is I've got my weaknesses, but if this platform is in place, the people can be come and go. If they understand what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about here is a viable way to govern the United States of America that is fiscally responsible, okay, but also appeals to the mainstream. This is not no two-bit little thing. The only thing here that really stretches you out is the legalization of drugs. And that is something that you'll get used to when you think about Prohibition, 1933, I mean, shoot, we're going to legalize alcohol, folks. Everybody's going to be drunk all the time. They're all going to be falling all over the sidewalks, you know? It's going to be crazy. They legalized alcohol, they taxed the hay out of it, and what happened? The U.S. government stayed in business all the way through the Depression. I don't have to say anymore.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any more?
We do one more, though.
Peace.
Yes.
All right.
I got something
on the show.
What?
I got something real cool.
Yeah.
Okay. You're going to get the last word.
Okay.
You'll get the last word.
All right. I got to share this about Gus. Gus is saying about legalizing dope. Factually, there are 4 states in America where you can walk in, right? Actually, 4 states that have agreed to legally sell marijuana. Does anybody know what those 4 states are?
Colorado,
Washington State, Oregon? What's your other one?
Alaska.
Alaska. DC, they just decriminalized it, but they're not going to sell it. So right now, today, officially, you can walk into two states, Brother Gus, and legally buy pot. So the template's already there. And in 23 other states, you can buy pot medicinally with a doctor's order. So we got the templates in place. It's coming. It's coming.
It's taking way
coming.
Too long.
It's coming. It already is in Colorado. You can go right now to Colorado and you can go to Washington State and buy all the pot you want. Well, up to a certain amount.
The other states are way to see what's going to happen.
Yeah, of course. And nothing's happening in Colorado. The walls or the sky is not falling in Colorado or Washington State. It's beautiful. And at the end of this year, you will have Oregon and Alaska up and running selling pot as well. So that means you'll have four states out of 50 selling pot.
Yeah, the suburbanites
legally,
can allow this.
Recreationally. It's amazing.
More than anywhere.
Yeah, suburban moms are going to allow.
So what are we waiting for? The rest of the states. What are we waiting for?
Okay. Anybody else?
That's it. God forbid.
Anybody else?
That's wonderful.
All right. Our speaker gets the last word if nobody else wants to go.
Well, you turned it into a trivia thing after all. I don't believe it. Oh, my God.
I wanted to say a quick word about Whole Foods. I don't want to spend a lot of time on it. Whole Foods, its own products are supposed to be non-GMO, its own brands. I'm not going to either defend them or attack them. When I don't buy meat, I don't buy animal-derived foods. If I go in and I just buy vegetables and fruits that are in season or a few things from California, my bill really isn't any higher than when I get the same thing that's Jewel, organic. I only eat organics. So in that sense, but you're right. Whole Foods can be whole paycheck if you stray too far from that. And it's very easy to stray. Their marketing is very clever. I don't think that, in that sense, you have to make your own decision. At least that's been my experience shopping. I do a lot of shopping. The second thing is, about the states and drugs. I think that's one of the reasons we wanted state legislation when it was clear that Congress was not going to act. And all the state bills are pretty much modeled after the same model bill from the Food Safety Organization, which created a model bill that everybody can use so that the companies don't have to worry about a patchwork of different legislation in every single state. But apparently that's what they're hitting us with right now. As far as the table goes, there's a ton of stuff on the table. Help yourself to it.
Thank you.
Explains more. This sheet has a lot of stuff on the back of it, resources to go to. You can write to Terry at IRTKGMO, that's on the screen sheet. On that little postcard thing, you can write to me at legislabel.org@gmail.com. So you can reach us with any questions. As another thing that really is interesting in terms of what people will accept or not accept, we have something called the precautionary principle. My background is in law and public health. And public health speaks about the precautionary principle, which is basically saying if there's a suspected hazard, and there's enough credibility, enough documentation to give it some credibility, that, and if there is also some acceptable alternative that doesn't present that hazard, you choose people are justified in being able to choose the acceptable alternative. And that's all we're trying to do with labeling, is saying, yes, there is some credible information about hazards with genetically engineered food. It's never going to, you don't get proof in biology, you only get demonstration, and there is some demonstration that's persuasive, that's credible enough to be persuasive to many people. Those people should be able to make up their minds as to what they choose to feed themselves. That's a pretty intimate thing, the food you eat. So if they want to be able to eat something that's GMO, fine, they can do it. Non-GMO, fine, they can do it. But they can do that with clear, on-package, mandatory labeling.
All right.
Thank you.
All right.
You're wonderful. Thank you for being here.
One more round for our speaker.
Give us a chart.
Tim, you're blushing.
Thank you for coming. Hope to see you soon again.
Next week.
And next week, you know, we have a debate between Dennis Nelson and what's the other guy's name?
Next week is Ted Aranda.
No, next week, we're getting we'll get the schedule up here, Brahm. That's July 4th you're talking. Our next, Ted Aranda's next week.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.